Thank you, Mike. Good morning, everybody, and welcome back. I always know it's the end of the summer when Mike calls and says, hey, Ed, would you and Amy come over and do your presentation? And I check off the calendar and say, the summer's over. And I'm sure you feel a little bit that way, but also feel excited to come back as well. I'm Ed Sullivan. I'm an attorney with Fagery Baker Daniels. My colleague, Amy Steckety, also an attorney there. We work in the area, several areas, but one of our areas is working with public schools, and so we do school law. As part of that, we have gained a body of experience that we're not really all that excited to have. And it relates to handling situations, disciplining teachers, working with authorities when teachers have crossed the line and have been involved in interactions with students that become criminal or that raise the question of their continued employment with the school. I will tell you that, I don't know, Amy, would you say going back 6-8 years easily, every single school year, we've had one of our clients that have had to deal with this situation.
At least one.
So it is a widespread problem. We can talk and debate, and it's actually, I think, interesting and informative to talk and debate why. Is it because people don't know how to behave any longer? That we've blurred the lines between an adult and a child? We don't know the bounds of propriety any longer? Is it because people are reporting it more often? That children, young people, have found their voice and they know this is wrong? Is it because the authorities are more vigilant? I don't know. It might be a combination of all three. I think people will often talk about, oh, geez, you can't even be a coach or a teacher anymore. It's all regulation. They watch this, they watch that, they tell you can't do this or that. I don't think that's the right attitude. I think that's a recipe for disaster. We are here because Penn High School is on the forefront of dealing with these issues. And you have a policy, and the superintendent and the board have required there to be training in that policy every year. And I can tell you that when we meet with other school clients, we point to Penn as an example. And to echo Mike's opening, Penn State should have been doing what Penn High School has been doing. And so they're to be applauded, and you're to be applauded for being here. For many of you, it's not the first time you've seen us. For that, I apologize. Maybe we'll work up some new lawyers in our office and send them in the future because you may be tired of seeing us. Let me see a show of hands of folks who have been in this presentation in the past. Okay, and a show of hands of people who are brand new. Okay, for the new folks, I want to really emphasize to read the policy that we've handed out, that Mike has handed out. We'll hit some of the key points to it and talk about a few other implications of that policy. There's no substitute for actually sitting down and reading it. I guarantee you, somebody during the course of this year in this room will have to confront some aspect of this policy. I guarantee it. The only way I'm wrong in that is if you all stick it in a drawer, close your eyes, and don't pay any attention to the needs and the controversies and the important aspects of being a child in athletics in this modern era. And I know this staff too well. I know that's not going to happen. So I guarantee you, you're going to come to have to confront some aspect of the policy. So I appreciate you being here. We don't have a lot of time. We're going to move pretty quickly to make sure we hit the highlights and try and leave a little time at the end for a question or two. Our high-tech approach to this will be me pointing to Amy to tell her to flip the slide. Okay. So we're going to talk about the policy and the administrative guidelines related to student supervision and welfare. All right, here's one of the key things. Avoid the appearance of impropriety. Not just the impropriety, the appearance of it. Dr. Thacker has a great phrase that I've also stolen. As you act as a teacher, as a coach, just pretend everything you do is being videotaped. And if you're okay with that, you're probably going to be okay under this policy. All right, a professional staff member shall not associate or communicate with students at any time in any manner which gives the appearance of impropriety. And it goes through including but not limited to creation or participation in a situation or activity which could be considered abusive, sexually suggestive, involve illegal substances such as tobacco, alcohol, or drugs. The appearance of impropriety. So you don't want to be acting in a way that supports activity in that way or gives the appearance that you approve of it or that you're chuckling about it or you're talking about it in your own personal life. Okay? Now, this sentence, this provision should not be construed as precluding a professional staff member from associating with students in private for legitimate or proper reasons. And sometimes, you know, this is very lawyerly language, and it's kind of like, don't do this, but you can do that. And most of us live right here in the middle, right? Which means you need to use judgment. There are going to be judgment calls, and that's okay. And we can sort of talk about how to approach that. Some specifics: don't transport students in private vehicles without the approval of the principal. Don't require students to perform activities that may be detrimental to their health. Seek assistance in counseling students. We face situations where teachers, coaches get into trouble because they form a one-on-one relationship with a student because they say, well, I'm kind of their mentor or their counselor. Oh, okay. Now, do you have any background in that? Do you have any training in that? Are you licensed in that? Well, no, they just trusted me. If you're in that situation and you are the only one, you need to bring somebody else into that relationship. And there's, in a very detailed language, I think describes that obligation. And then at the bottom bullet point there, report to proper legal authorities immediately any sign of suspected child abuse or neglect. We will come to talk about what that means in more detail. Notice the bold word there, immediately. We have been involved in helping some of our school clients in which people tried to do the right thing, but it wasn't immediate. And the authorities get upset at that. We'll talk about that more as well. What is child abuse or neglect? The policy defines it. Every case, whether ascertained or suspected of abuse, abandonment, cruelty, neglect, okay? You're not the proper party to investigate and decide, did it happen? Not your role. In some sense, you should feel good about that, right? That's not your job. But you are the first point of contact, and you need to get somebody involved, and that information needs to get to the proper people. You're not the ones to investigate. If there's doubt, report. All right, what is abuse or neglect? A few examples. It's both emotional and physical. And you can't just assume it's physical. On the emotional side, as coaches, challenge yourself. Yes, you can be demanding. I was lucky enough to have a Hall of Fame coach in high school, Ben Krajiak. We used to call him Crazy Ben. He was demanding, but he was not mean. He was not demeaning. He held us accountable. He didn't embarrass us. He would teach, not attack. And then I want to point to this word here, hazing, along with, look, the other word in that line, prevent hazing. It doesn't call for you to say, don't haze. It doesn't call for you to say, don't support hazing. It says prevent it. It requires proactive behavior on your part to prevent hazing. On the physical side, ensure participants are not hit, slapped, thrown, or grabbed. You're not forced to undergo excessive exercise, conditioning, or drills as a form of punishment. I'd also challenge you, it's tough to find those kind of punishment things. You're going to run, you know, gassers or line drills or something if somebody's out of line. I understand that. But remember this, conditioning is absolutely critical to any sports team. And you don't want your players to associate in their minds that conditioning is really punishment. Conditioning enables them to be great, and you don't want them to associate conditioning as punishment. Some more examples of abuse or neglect, harassment. There's a recent OCR means Office of Civil Rights. Recent guidance from the Office of Civil Rights on bullying and discrimination, which includes in the harassment definition, not just harassment, gender harassment, or sexual harassment, but also for sexual orientation. And you will often confront students who have a different sexual orientation, and you cannot single people out like that. And there's some recent guidance by the Office of Civil Rights on that, so I want to highlight that. Neglect is also a form of abuse, not properly treating injuries, forcing people to play hurt, inadequate equipment, lack of supervision, etc. The next slide is, I think, more for your reference, and it basically goes through and tells you the different levels of what is considered sexual abuse under Indiana law. These are criminal statutes that we're summarizing here. Note the first one. Any sexual contact with a child under the age of 14 is considered sexual abuse, even if the contact was with another child of any age. So I think you have to be sensitive to interactions between students that might be abusive that you should be tuned into. I'll let you look at those others on your own. Note the bottom, sexting. Or text messages of a sexual nature can be a reason to believe that there's an abusive situation going on. We've dealt with that issue as well. We think texting can be a dangerous way to relate to your students. We'll flip and I'll hand off to Amy.
I want to talk a little bit about the duty to report abuse. In the past year, we've had some really tragic incidents of child abuse in this county. And that has brought significant attention to this issue. Both sort of what are the duties to report? How does it apply? It's people have paid attention in schools. The prosecutors have paid attention to it also. And so we think it bears, you know, reminding at this point about what exactly your duties are and how do you discharge them. There are two duties. One is the individual duty. And that's the duty that applies to anyone across the state. Anyone who has a reason to believe that there's any kind of child abuse or neglect has an obligation to report. There's a second duty as a school official, and that duty is to report it to individually notify or immediately notify the individual in charge of the school. Typically, that's going to be the principal. The principal may have a designated receiver of reports, but the principal has identified who that person is. So you have that duty to report individually. You have the duty to report to the school official. I think the one thing that's important to know is that you don't discharge that individual duty simply by reporting it to the school official. You still have that individual duty. The way you discharge that individual duty is by following up with the person that you've reported it to at the school, the principal, and making sure that the principal or whoever the designated reporter is has in fact made a report. That's what you need to do. So it's imperative to follow up. And when more than one school official has knowledge, which is typically the way it happens, each individual person who has a reason to believe that there's abuse has to follow up with a designated reporter just to make sure a report's been made.
I don't want to interrupt, but a quick question. Getting
sure.
Back to the Penn State case, the guy who saw it going on in the gymnasium then reported it to the coach, why wasn't he held to a higher standard? It's like no one ever blamed him for not doing more. Breaking it up. I mean, I don't understand how he got off so easy.
That's a great question. And I don't know what the law is in Pennsylvania. If it were Indiana and we're subject to this law in Indiana, he would be charged, too, for failing to report. And our prosecutor has charged people, school officials, just in the past year with sort of failing to report and failing to follow up to ensure reports made. And I think a lot of this comes from the Penn State incident, the incidents of child abuse here in our county. So I just want to highlight some of the consequences, you know, in addition to the moral, you know, moral issue of, you know, attempting to prevent and, you know, stop any kind of child abuse. There are some criminal charges, too. It's a Class B misdemeanor for both of those, for both the failure to report as an individual and the failure to report to a school official. Okay. There are lots of boundaries, not every boundary. Between an educator and a student becomes inappropriate. And not every boundary is blurred, and not every boundary becomes child abuse. Penn has decided to identify lots of behaviors that could qualify as blurred boundaries and things that are indicators of child abuse. And they've been sort of listed in the policy that's been distributed to you, the administrative guidelines. I want to highlight some of the ones I think that are sort of red flags of possible blurred boundaries. Giving gifts of a personal nature to a specific student unless approved by the employee's supervisor. Going to a student's home when the student's parent or guardian or proper chaperone is not present. Taking a student on an outing without obtaining prior express permission of the student's parent or guardian. And giving a student ride in the employee's personal vehicle. Now, one thing that I want to point out is, and this is an excerpt directly from the administrative guidelines, is the very first sentence, in the absence of a legitimate professional purpose. Now, there could be legitimate reasons for doing any of these things or any of the things that are listed on the next slide, but it's really important to make sure that you've cleared that, that you've sort of established that legitimate professional purpose before engaging in any of these activities. And you do that by communicating with a supervisor, by communicating with a principal, someone about what the legitimate purpose is. So some more, using email, text messaging, or instant messaging. This is an issue that is always a problem, and it's difficult because there are so many great advantages of using technology to communicate with students, but it's important to do it in a way that both protects yourself and protects the student. Allowing a specific student to engage in misconduct that's not tolerated from other students, some kind of favoritism, granting the student special favors that would not be given to other students, discussing with the student the employee's problems, typical to discussing adult problems with students, making regular physical contact with the student, hugging or other physical contact, and then on the next slide, these are the things that I think are more obvious. And here we're getting much closer to actually crossing the line between blurred boundaries and something that may qualify as abuse. We're talking about invading a student's physical privacy, telling sexual jokes, discussing with the student sexual topics, alcohol use, drug use, or illegal substance abuse, showing sexually inappropriate materials, making any sexual advances, written, verbal, or physical, towards a student, and then, of course, engaging in any sexual activity or dating a student. Okay?
Okay. Now, in addition to that, I think there are some things that we need to look for as a community of teachers and coaches to be able to really commit ourselves that it's not going to happen on my watch. So these are things that might not specifically be mentioned, or there may be a little overlap here, but from our experience, there's things to look for. Not just for yourself. You don't look at this list and say, well, I don't do any of those things. You have to look around to protect students. Number one, yes. But to protect yourselves, protect each other from misapprehensions and misunderstandings that could get you in trouble, right? So, close personal relationship with students, time alone. You see something, they spend a lot of time alone. They always seem to have these little conferences in the coach's office with the door closed. It's a red flag. Overly familiar conduct. Okay, this is something that, and I've talked about this before with this group, it's a lot different than when I was in high school. There was a distance between the student and even a young teacher or coach. They didn't make the same kind of jokes, same kind of, even TV references that might be extremely sexual or inappropriate, and now you're referencing, it's a different world. Because of that, we have to be more heightened. Change in the student's behavior. You see them withdrawing from friends and personality changes, etc. Or you see them having those personality changes only when a particular coach is around. Change in the behavior of the coach or teacher. They're withdrawn from colleagues. They won't talk to you about something. They get angry when you bring up that particular student. Inviting the student to an educator's class during non-class time, allowing students to get away with inappropriate behavior and rumors about a relationship, right? You've got to follow up on these things. So what do? When you observe it, number one rule, don't ignore it. So either there's nothing wrong, there's nothing inappropriate going on, and you just raised it. So what's the worst thing that can happen? The person goes through, satisfies any concerns you have, and you have pointed out a potentially damaging situation for that particular teacher or coach about the appearance of it, and you've cleared it up. No harm, you've done good. So that's one possibility that you were wrong and nothing bad's happened. The other possibility is something is going on, and you've confronted it and highlighted it. So I think there's no harm that comes from addressing it, although there is harm that can come from ignoring it, okay? investigate a rumor or a red flag or a sign of something going on, you need to follow up. Find out if anyone else sees things the way you do. Ask assistance if they have concern. Discuss your concern with the AD or the HR head or the principal. Form a plan. Okay? Talk to other coaches and address the perceptions, citing specific examples. Words, phrases like, I'm concerned that it appears that your relationship with Johnny, Susie, whatever, has become too friendly. We need to help reestablish the boundaries. You don't walk in and say, I think you're a child abuser. Let's talk about it. Okay? You can raise the issue without accusing. Inquire, strategize and plan, brainstorm. Just here's some things to sort of check off if you have a concern, how to follow up. Again, some more examples about how to do this. For your own good, I need to tell you that it looks really bad when after practice, after every practice, you have a meeting with that student in the coach's office with the door closed. That doesn't look good. I need to help you in this situation. Okay, those kinds of things. All right? We've gone fast, but I know that you have other things to do today. And we've hit a lot of points. I hope that you will take a look at what we've passed out, and if you have questions and follow-up, please filter them through Mike, or you can send us an email. If you have a question about this presentation, we're not going to go on the clock and charge the school just to respond to an inquiry about this presentation. And if you have a question or so about what we've thrown out in the very quickly, we'd welcome that at this time.
Yes. Grad gifts, no problem with that, right?
I'm sorry?
Graduation gifts, I mean, a lot of us. For our players, but a lot of that's okay to give a graduation.
Yeah, I think at that point, as they're graduating, right, there's a lot of changes in that relationship. I think it's important that they are of an appropriate graduation gift. And the most important thing about that is it's uniform, right? It's not just one person you're showing gifts on, but it's to the seniors, right? And that Coach Prajak, right, Mr. Lehrman, they know and understand what's going on. Right? So you give a heads up. Hey, we do this when they graduate. All my football players, I give them, you know, whatever, a $10 Starbucks card or something along that line. Right. Anybody else? Thank you. As always, you've been very attentive, and we appreciate that. Good luck this year as teachers and as coaches. We appreciate your attention.
Make sure you sign the sheet that's passed around and put it in my box down there.